Player 2 is a 50-point Linux machine on Hack2Box. For user, we are required to do some web fuzzing, call a twerp method on an API endpoint to get credentials, finding hidden backup TOTP codes, and finally bypassing a signature check on a firmware sample we can upload. This firmware is then automatically executed by the server. Finally, we must subscribe to the running Mosquito MQTT service to find an SSH private key. For root, there's an unintended way to use MQTT to leak the root flag and a heap exploit. After scanning the box, we can see that two web servers are running in addition to SSH. We start by looking at the website on port 80 and can see some information about ongoing development on something called Protops. There are also some references to the Player 1 box, but nothing that would help us here. We continue by fuzzing for additional virtual hosts and after a moment find product.player2.htb. When we visit this page, we get the login form, but as we don't have credentials, this is not too useful yet. On port 8545, we get an error message that shows that this is something related to twerp. It turns out this is some protocol Twitch uses for RPC, and in the docs we can find some sample requests. To use this endpoint, we have to figure out how the app is called and what functions it has, so we fuzz some more. Eventually, we find the generated.proto file, which contains the definitions we were looking for. We can see the package name twerp.player2.auth with the function gencreds that takes a number as input. Using curl, we call this function and get back some credentials. If you repeat this, you will get different credentials. Some of these are valid and some are not, so you might have to try a few. Eventually, we succeed with JKR's credentials, but are asked for a one-time pad for two-factor authentication, which we do not have. So we go back to fuzzing again, this time hoping to find some kind of API that indeed exists. We guess the TOTP endpoint and can see that it doesn't seem to want a GET request. By changing to POST, we get a different error, this time saying that the action is invalid. When we provide an action, it tells us that we are missing parameters. This is a bit misleading, as the real reason is that the action is just wrong. By trying a few ones, we eventually find the correct action, backup underscore codes, which gives us the backup TOTP code for JKR, with which we can finally log in. Now we can see a pretty cool looking site mentioning Protops again. This site links to a PDF that contains some information about the Protops firmware, especially a rough overview on how the firmware signing process works. On the bottom we find two links, one to download the firmware and one that leads to an upload form where we can upload the firmware for testing purposes. After downloading the firmware tar file, we have a look at its contents. Besides the firmware binary, it contains an info.txt file with some license information and a version file that just contains the firmware version. Since the file tool does not detect a file type, we open it in a hex editor and have a closer look. Right at the start, we can see that this is actually an ELF file, but some data has been prepended, probably the signature that was mentioned earlier. Scrolling down a bit, we see a shell command starting with stty. This is interesting, as we might be able to modify this one without making any considerable modifications to the binary. Before making any changes, we confirm that uploading the firmware file works on the page that was linked earlier and see that it indeed works. Now we can try to modify the binary and see if the signature check still passes. We added the shell command we saw, so a w gets a file from our box and stores it in a temp directory. Then we create a tar archive from it that we can upload. For the actual payload, we will use Metasploit, so we start a multi-handler and then generate the payload. When we upload the file, we can see that the signature check still passes and that our inserted command is executed. So why does this still work? The signature is only created over some of the starting bytes of the binary, so manipulations after the signed region don't invalidate the signature. Now we modify the binary again, this time making our uploaded payload executable and then executed. We upload the file and get a reverse shell in Metasploit. The user this shell is running as is www.data, so there is no user flag here yet. Using netstat, we can see that there's an unusual service on localhost port 1883. This is a MQTT server, so we can use the MQTT client to receive messages on it. We connect to the server with Mosquito Sub, which is installed, and subscribe to sys. Now we can see a ton of messages, and if we wait a moment, some magic will happen and the private SSH key of Observer, a user on the box, will be shown. We copy the key and can now SSH into the box and read the user flag. Now there's an unintended way to get the root flag by abusing the last step we just did. The script, which is reading the key file from Observer and putting it into Mosquito, is run as root, so we can replace the ID RSR file with a symlink to root.txt. So now, instead of getting the SSH key, we will get the root flag when printing the MQTT messages. In the next part, we will have a short look at the heap exploit that was involved in the intended way to root. After downloading the protops binary and involved libc and ld binaries, we check with ldd how it's linked. It expects the libc and ld files in opt configuration utilities. Now it would be a bit problematic to debug this locally because we don't have the same libc version installed. This is especially a problem for PwnDebug because it needs the libc debug symbols for its heap commands. To solve this issue, we will create a Docker container that runs the exact same version of libc and develop our exploit here. We run the container and confirm that the downloaded libc matches the one in the container. Now we copy in a fixed sources.list file because you have to use the old release subdomain to get updates for Ubuntu 19.04. We install some packages we need, for example PwnDebug, PwnTools and OneGadget. Since we mounted our local working directory on the host into the container, we can now write the exploit on the host and run it inside the container. A last thing we have to do is to use patch-elf, so it uses the system's libc and not the custom one in opt configuration utility. Now we can start with the exploit development process. To speed this up a bit, I split the exploit in different stages and hope I can show some logical progression here. You run the binary and can see that it looks like a typical heap exploit challenge where you can create, read and delete objects on the heap. The first thing we do is write a short Python script that starts the binary, wraps the menu so we can call functions when we want to use the menu options. So when we run the binary, it just starts and stops. In the next iteration, I added a createConfig call followed by readConfig. Note that we only set the name field, the description size and the description contents. In addition, I attached GDB here so we can get some insight. Because PwnTools cannot spawn a new terminal window from inside Docker, we use tmux. Our breakpoint is triggered inside readconfig just before the output is printed. I got this address from IDA Pro when looking at the readconfig function. In GDB, we can see the address this printf statement is printing from. It turns out, by not filling up the full description, there exists a libc pointer conveniently inside the description area. This is great news as we acquire a libc leak and basically get one for free. Our next exploit iteration just adds some code that reads, stores and prints the leaked value. In addition, we calculated the offset from this leak to the base address of libc. We run the exploit and can see the leak. By running vmmap inside GDB, we confirm that this leaked address is indeed in libc. To calculate the offset in an easy way, just copy-paste the values into an interactive Python shell and print them out. After having the leak part done, we continue by creating four configurations. By using PwnDebug's wiz command, we can now visualize how this looks on the heap. We can see the area that is used for the name, followed by the area for the description. These 41 and 51 are size fields, which contain the size of the chunk itself. These sizes are 8-byte aligned, and their three least significant bits are used for flags. When we scroll down, we can see the other chunks we created as well. In the next iteration, we will exploit a full heap overflow. We delete the configs with C's and D's and create another one with M's. This new one will be created at the same spot where the C's were earlier because they have the same size. Nothing too exciting so far. But it turns out that if we provide a really long name when creating a config, it will overflow into the description area and even beyond its bounds, resulting in a full heap overflow. Let's see how this looks in GDB. As expected, we now have the M's area next to the B's. The interesting part is the name field. Despite being interrupted, it's continuing into the description area. In this case, it fills up the whole size of the chunk. The area adjacent to this chunk is the D's area we freed earlier. When freeing a chunk that was allocated by malloc, heap metadata will be placed inside the freed area. This metadata is used, amongst other things, to keep tracks of freed memory fragments so they can be combined or reused. In this version of libc 2.29, a mechanism called tcache exists. By freeing the D's area, we put a pointer to this free area into a tcache bin. The reason for this is that when we want to allocate hex 38 bytes again, we can be given this small free area, which would be a perfect fit. Let's look at the next iteration. Not much has changed. We only added 16 more bytes to the name field of the last config creation. This will now override heap metadata. So let's observe this in GDB. It looks similar to before, as expected. With the bins command, we can see that we have a weird entry in our tcache bins list consisting of the O's we added. This means that on the next allocation, malloc would try to give us memory from this unaccessible address, because we have overwritten the part of the metadata that points to the next free chunk of the memory of that size. Now we are almost done. Instead of writing a bunch of O's there, we write an address of free hook. Any address different from 0 and free hook will be called whenever a chunk of memory is freed. To get the address of free hook, we can just print it out in GDB. As we can see, that value is now 0, and by running bins, we can confirm that instead of our O's, we now have a pointer to free hook in the tcache bin list. To continue, we now create another config at the end, which has the same size the free D area had. Malloc will now use the heap metadata pointer we overwrote with the address to free hook to determine which memory to reserve for our allocation. In GDB, we can see that we indeed got our allocation at the address of free hook, and our custom value was written to it. For the actual payload, we can use one gadget. We use one of the values and replace the dead code address with the new one. After running the now completed local exploit, we get a shell. Getting this to work on the remote end is a bit tricky. It basically is the same exploit, but the base offset to libc is slightly different. I found the correct offset by fuzzing the last byte a bit. Other than that, the only thing that changed is that we now use SSH to connect to the real binary instead of our local one. We now get a root shell and can read the root flag.